I am Dr. Balaji Chinnaswamy from SRM Medical College Hospital, Chennai. So I thought we will have some important topic for exams. So I have chosen pediatric instruments, which will be almost for everyone. It will come in Viva. So let's see. If you have any doubts, please type them in the chat box. I can chat box or in the comment section. I am happy to clarify those doubts. So let's move on. So there are some important instruments which we need to be familiarized. One is your LP needle, bone marrow aspiration needle, bone marrow biopsy needle, and thoracentesis, paracentesis using three-way valve, IV cannula, NG feeding tubes, meter dose inhaler with spacer, oxygen mask, ambu bag with reservoir, endotracheal tube, and other instruments which I will be just dealing with. So coming on with the LP needle, so it's the lumbar puncture needle. So we have a the LP needle, we have a stylet, and we have the needle. So sterile spinal needle with the stylet is the usual thing. The size is 22 gauge. We usually use for children 22 gauge, which will be color coded as black in color, and length may vary. Main questions they will ask is, why is LP needle used? It is used for diagnosing meningitis, encephalitis, and other CNS infections. So lumbar puncture for diagnosing infection. You can instill any dye for imaging purposes. You can measure the CSF pressure. And therapeutically also, you can give medications, especially the chemotherapy for leukemia can be given intrathecally. Spinal anesthesia can also be given through the lumbar puncture. So these are the, you have diagnostic purpose as well as a therapeutic purpose. And the contraindication, one important contraindication, if there is elevated intracranial pressure, or if there is a mass lesion, especially if the fundus has papilledema and a head CT shows some space occupying lesion, lumbar puncture is contraindicated. It can result in coning. And if the platelets are low, less than 20,000, better not to do lumbar puncture as it can cause hemorrhage. And if the child is unstable with severe respiratory distress and shock, it can worsen with the positioning and flexioning. So it is contraindicated. Complication after lumbar puncture, main important complication is the headache, depending upon the size of the LP needle. So use a smaller bore needle, the headache might be less. And if you are doing it in a raised ICT, cerebral herniation and even sudden death is possible with lumbar puncture. So rule out a raised intracranial tension before doing the lumbar puncture needle. Procedure in the lateral recommend position. So remember the L2, L3, L3, L4. So usually it is the L3, L4 place where you do the lumbar puncture. It is exactly the line connecting the posterior superior iliac crest. And it is the place where the spinal cord ends, and hence it is safer to do the lumbar puncture. You ask if the baby is infant, you can even go below. So it could be L5, S1 if the baby is an infant or newborn. But usual position, it is L3, L4, L2, L3. Okay. And coming to the bone marrow aspiration needle, the name is Salas bone marrow aspiration needle. So why we use bone marrow aspiration? In order to diagnose leukemias, bone marrow infiltrations like lymphomas and other non-hematological malignancies, and also to rule out malignant process in ITP. And sometimes you can even take a culture from bone marrow using bone marrow aspiration, for example, for typhoid, because even if you start antibiotics, the bone marrow culture will still be giving you yield for salmonella. So bone marrow aspiration for culture, for diagnosing of malignancies. So on looking at the picture, you should be able to make out Salas bone marrow aspiration needle. So you have, as usual, a stylet, a cannula, and a guard. So there is a guard which is meant to So there is a guard which will prevent the further which will avoid too much depth in insertion of the bone marrow aspiration needle. So you know how much depth you have to go. So that is the guard. So you have a stilet which will help in preventing the bony material clogging the cannula. Okay, so that is the reason why you have a stilet. Okay. So the procedure, you put the patient in the prone position and identify the posterior iliac spine, and you start going through in a screwing movement. There will be a giveaway feeling. The giveaway feeling means you have entered the bone marrow. So from there, you remove the stilet and use the syringe to draw the bone marrow material to aspirate the marrow contents. So you can even choose the tibia, but make sure that the needle is directed away from the knee joint, as it can damage the growth epiphysis. Okay, so this is the bone marrow aspiration needle. So once you reach the bone marrow, there will be a giveaway. The site is posterior iliac spine, posterior superior iliac spine. You can also do it in the tibia. Okay, so this is the picture. So once there is a giveaway, you start aspirating the contents. Then comes bone marrow biopsy needle. The difference being bone marrow biopsy needle is a lot bigger on comparing, on keeping it side by side. You can easily say which is the aspiration needle, which is the biopsy needle. Biopsy needle is going to be very bigger in size. So the Jamshedi trephine biopsy needle. Jamshedi trephine biopsy needle, we are going to use the posterior iliac spine, the same posterior iliac spine. So what is the procedure? It also has a stilet. It also has a cannula. Okay, so you pierce the bone with a boring movement. Once there is a giveaway, once you have reached the bone marrow, you remove the stilet and keep advancing the needle using to and fro motions until you have a bit of a bone chunk. Here you are not aspirating, you are actually taking real bone chunk inside the needle. And then finally you make slides of it. So bone marrow biopsy is much better with regards to the pathology and assessment, but it is more invasive, more painful. So it has to be done carefully. Okay. So Jamshedi needle, Jamshedi bone marrow biopsy needle, same procedure. And it doesn't have a guard. If you look, it doesn't have a guard. And your aim is to take a chunk of the bone marrow. And one more, often they might ask, what is the use of intraosseous bone marrow aspiration needle in addition to diagnostic purpose? It can be used for gaining intraosseous access. Whenever IV line is not possible, when the child is very sick, child is in shock, veins are collapsed, you can go for the intraosseous access. Usually we prefer the tibial tuberosity, 1 to 2 centimeter below the tibial tuberosity, just medial to it, you insert it. And once you enter the bone marrow, you can aspirate it. You can take samples for blood sugar and other investigations. And you can give fluids, you can give antibiotics and drugs and blood till you get the IV line. Preferably till 6 hours, you can use the intraosseous access. Then comes thoracentesis. It is nothing but taking content from the pleural cavity whenever there is a pleural effusion or empyema, or for diagnostic purpose, thoracentesis. So remember the parts, you need a needle, you need a cannula to connect the needle, a three-way adapter, a syringe, and then a drainage bag or a collection bag. So this is what you will be needing. And mark the penetration site at least 2 inches below the scapular tip. So you're going to mark it at least 2 inches below the scapular tip. Make sure it is 1 to 2 centimeter below the upper border of the dullness area of the percussion. So it should be, the area should be very well dull, and make sure it is two inches below the scapular tip. And then the patient is made to sit position, leaning on the table, and start withdrawing it. And using the three-way adapter, start pushing it into the collection bag. So you remove pull push technique. So you pull the fluid or empyema, and then you turn the three-way adapter and push it into the collection bag. So this is how the thoracentesis is done. But it is an invasive procedure. You can puncture the lungs or pneumothorax. You can have a hemopneumothorax, hemorrhage. And when you do such a painful procedure, vesovagal response and hypotension, and other you can cause air embolism, and you can rupture the spleen or liver nearby. So these are the complications possible. Ascitic tap or paracentesis, also similar push-pull technique using a three-way adapter and a syringe. But remember the position, the landmark. The landmark is between the at the junction of the medial two-third and the lateral one-third of an imaginary line drawn from the anterior superior iliac spine to the umbilicus. Drawn from the anterior superior iliac spine to the umbilicus, medial two-third and lateral one-third, it is the place where you will be doing the ascitic fluid tap. And coming to the oxygen sources, you have a simple face mask. The first picture I'm showing is the simple face mask. It just delivers 40 to 60% of the oxygen, and you need a higher amount of oxygen to be delivered. So remember, there is a bag sort of thing in the mask. Then it is called the non-rebreathing mask. So simple mask, non-rebreathing mask, which has a reservoir. This can deliver up to 90% of oxygen. So remember, there is a reservoir, then it is going to deliver high amount of oxygen. It is the non-rebreathing mask. Then in order to not getting confused, suppose there is a chamber below, it is the nebulization chamber, and this mask is used for nebulization. So nebulization chamber for nebulization, reservoir for non-rebreathing mask, and simple mask which gives 40 to 60%. Remember, the size of the mask also should be correct for children. It should cover the nose, mouth, and the chin. It should not cover the eyes. And you have cushioned type of face mask. In the last picture, I'm showing the cushioned type of face mask and uncushioned. Cushioned will cause less injury. Similarly, you have a circular type of mask as well as a mask that are triangular and fits the anatomy of the face. And in children, we also use oxygen hood. This is almost a full box. Oxygen hood, which covers the head, which with front there is a provision for the neck and head to go inside, and back you have a provision for the oxygen to get connected. It's almost like the baby is in a different planet full of oxygen. So oxygen hood. So advantages: it is non-invasive, you are not troubling the child, it allows humidification of oxygen. The disadvantage is the any change in position, the hood, there will be leakage. So the baby turns, the hood starts leaking. So oxygen concentration may not be fully delivered, and you cannot feed the baby. The baby is inside the hood, head is inside the hood. You cannot feed the baby, and hence the baby keeps crying, and it is poorly tolerated. It is not so well tolerated, but it is not invasive. The baby is sleeping, then hood is the best. Similarly, you have one more oxygen delivery system. It is the nasal prongs, where at the end there are two prongs which will fit into the nostrils. Here oxygen is administered to the baby, and it the advantage is the baby is comfortable and you can feed the baby. That is the advantage, you can feed the baby. And now coming to the bag and mask. Okay, so bag and mask, you have a lot of parts. You have a reservoir bag. Remember, you have a reservoir bag. So this is very important, because without the reservoir bag, the amount of delivery, the oxygen delivery, will be only 40 to 60%. Only when the reservoir bag is attached, you will be getting 90% of oxygen. Then you have an oxygen inlet tubing from where oxygen will go inside, and you have a pop-off valve where if you give excess pressure, the pop-off valve will open up and prevent damage to the lungs. And you have a fish mouth expiratory valve, which is a one-way valve. Oxygen goes inside, but when the baby expires, oxygen will not go into the ambu bag. And you have a face mask. So remember, this is a self-inflating bag. You press and leave, the bag is going to come back to its position. So most important question they might ask you is, where is the pop-off valve and where is the fish mouth expiratory valve? And they might ask you, what is the use of this reservoir? It gives only when the reservoir is there, the amount of oxygen you are giving is 90%. If it is not there, you're going to give only 40% of the oxygen. And sometimes the reservoir will not be like a balloon. It might be like a corrugated tube also. It will be like a corrugated tube. And it's what is the main purpose of ambu bag? It's to give positive pressure ventilation as a temporary basis. Initially, when the baby is in arrest, you give positive pressure ventilation with bag and mask, and if it is going to persist, you are going to intubate and connect it with the ventilator. And the positioning is very important. Slight sniffing position where the head is slightly extended. It should not be flexed. And remember, the mask, you should use the EC clamp technique. So the C clamp for holding the mask and the E clamp for fixing with the jaw. So EC clamp technique. And use a self-inflating bag with volume at least 500 ml. So your bag and mask should be at least 500 ml. Below that, it's not acceptable. For older children, you can have 1000 ml. And you should remember, you should not press the full bag. You should not compress the full bag. You should just press enough to just cause a chest rise. The chest should just rise. That much only pressure you should give. If you give too much, it's going to damage the lung and pneumothorax is going to be a problem. Okay. And so you are going to connect to a minimum of 10 to 15 liters per minute of oxygen to the bag and mask. Okay. 10 to 15 liters per minute has to be given. And during resuscitation, 100% oxygen. So give only 100% oxygen, no room air ventilation and all. So you have to give 100% oxygen. Okay. And this is the feeding tube, infant feeding tube. What is the main purpose? You put the tube. If the baby is not feeding, you can feed through it. You can do a stomach wash. If the baby has taken something for poisoning, you can give a stomach wash and remove those poison substance. You can give medication. You can feed the baby through the NG tube. So these are the advantages. You have different sizes from number 5 to number 10, depending upon the various ages of the feeding tube. But remember, the end of the feeding tube will be a bit of pointed and it will be sort of closed. Why I am saying is you have to differentiate from the suction catheter, which has color coded. Okay, it might look like a feeding tube, but it has color-coded tubes and the end is flat. Okay, it's not pointed, it is flat and it is meant for suction. And remember, some might ask the how will you insert the position. The length to be inserted is from the nostril to the tragus of the ear and then to the Ziffy sternum. And once you have inserted it, how to confirm? You push air through the tube and auscultate in the epigastrium whether you are hearing the sound or not. So that is how you are confirming the position. Okay. And this is the MDI spacer, metered drug inhaler. Metered drug inhaler with spacer. Okay. You in asthma, usually we prefer inhalers, which are metered dose inhalers, which on pressing will give a dose of fixed dose of drug. But the problem is when you press it, the baby or the child has to inspire and hold it for a while, which is not possible in most of the children. They cannot cooperate. So you need a spacer. Spacer is nothing but a chamber or a empty container where after pressing it, all the content goes into the container. And the baby or the child, when comfortable, can take the drug. So it's always recommended for younger children to have the meter dose inhaler with the spacer, with mask. For more than 3 years, it's for almost all children, use a meter dose inhaler with a spacer. Because spacer, the coordination problem will not be there. So the child need not take inspiration when each time you press. The child can take at its own comfort time. Okay. And you have dry powder inhalers where you have capsules of drugs which gets broken in these devices. But the issue is more than 5 years only possible. You need a good amount of respiratory effort and these drugs can get deposited. The powder can get deposited and can cause candidiasis, etc. But the advantage is it's a portable device. You can just put it in the pocket. You need not have a big spacer. It's comfortable and portable. You can take and go. Okay. Then you have this nebulizer. A nebulizer is also to deliver the salbutamol and steroids. But the advantage is if the child is very sick and cannot have its own inspiratory effort, then nebulizer can be utilized. Okay. Then comes endotracheal intubation. So once you give positive pressure ventilation, you feel that you need more positive pressure ventilation, you need to continue your ventilation, assisted ventilation, then it's better to intubate. For intubation, you need the laryngoscope. So laryngoscope is used for intubation, and also you can give the surfactant in newborn after intubation. Okay, so you have different blades from 0, 1, 2, 3, 0 size for newborns and 3 for higher more than 10 years. So that is the size of the blades, and you have two types of blades. One is the straight blade and the curved blade. Straight blade, straight L is straight. So Miller's blade is straight. For younger children, we use that. And for adults, almost we use this McIntosh blade. C is curved. McIntosh, McIntosh has C, which is curved. So curved blade in McIntosh and straight blade in Miller's. Okay. And using the laryngoscope, we insert the endotracheal tube. Endotracheal tubes are basically PVC tubes, curved tubes, which is used for inserting. And it has an adapter. Adapter is the end whitish thing where you connect the ventilator to it, or the tubings, ventilator tubings or Wagon mask to it. And you have a curved tubes. And at the end, you have a Murphy's eye, which is a opening. Suppose it gets clogged, there is a side port which will help you out. So that is the Murphy's opening. At the end, you have a blackish thing which will tell you the vocal cord guide. That is the place where you should place at the vocal cords. So that is the vocal cord guide. So you have an adapter, you have a vocal cord guide, and you have the Murphy's eye, and all the centimeters to tell you the distance. And the whole ET tube has a radio opaque marker so that you can take X-ray and say where the tube is. So you have a radio opaque marker in the tube. And you have two types, cuffed and uncuffed. For younger neonates and all, you can use the uncuffed. And as the child is older, use cuffed tubes. Cuffed tubes prevents the air leaks. The leaks, the seal is tight, so there will be less of air leaks. And suppose you don't want aspiration, then cuffed tube is a good option. And the size of the tube starts from 2.5. 2.5 is basically the millimeter is the inner diameter. What is the diameter of the ET tube? Based on that, you have the sizes. So 2.5 is the inner diameter. And for 6 years, the size of the ET tube comes around 8. So 2.5 to 8, is there any formula? It is 8 by 4 plus 4 is the size for ET tube. And coming to the liver biopsy is used for cirrhosis, for any malignancies which is causing hepatomegaly. And especially newborns, suppose the child has neonatal hepatitis, to rule out biliary atresia, you go for liver biopsy. What are the prerequisites? The prothrombin time should be good. There should not be big bleeding tendencies. So do a blood group and cross matching and make sure you are given vitamin K. Make sure the prothrombin time is good. And this is the Wilms-Silverman needle, which is used for the liver biopsy. There are other needles, Mangani needle, true cut needle. But remember to identify this Wilms-Silverman needle, which is almost similar to your bone marrow aspiration needle. But the stillet is bifurcated. The stillet is bifurcated. So that is the important clue that it is Wilms-Silverman needle. Okay. And other instruments, almost I have finished the very important parts. Other instruments which you should know are the airway. This is the Goodall airways. This is to keep in an unconscious patient, keep the tongue from falling back, keep the airway patent. Keeping the airway patent. So this is the Goodall's airway. The sizes are different, and it is meant to prevent the tongue bite also. Sizes are different. The exact sizes from the angle of the mouth to the mandible, angle of the mandible, that will tell you the size of your Goodall's airway. Okay, then you have tongue depressor to examine the oral cavity and also test the gag reflex. You have different color-coded IV cannulas. Usually neonates have this yellow color-coded cannulas. For children, we use blue color cannulas, and for adults, we start using adolescents green color cannulas. Okay, so you have this yellow color and blue color coded IV cannulas for securing. Okay, and insulin syringe and tuberculin syringe, remember to differentiate. Insulin 1 ml has 40 units of insulin. So insulin syringe will be divided into 40 units. So if you look, it will be like 10, 20. So it will be divided according to the units. So for administering the insulin syringe, tuberculin syringe will be a 1 cc syringe, which is used to do the manto testing. Foley's catheter, you all know that it comes in different sizes. You have a balloon, you have to inflate the balloon in order for it to retain in the urinary bladder. Okay. And you have already understood the three-way cannula. Three-way cannula is meant for the push-pull technique. You aspirate the fluid from the thoracentesis and push it into the specimen collection bag. So three-way cannula is meant for that. And usually you can give the two different types of fluids, IV fluids, and suppose drugs like dopamine can be given using this three-way cannula. Okay, so I think I have come to the end. There are other instruments also. It may vary in department wise. So if you have any doubts, you can post in the chat section or the comment section. I'm happy to help you out.